come on. For greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, come on. For greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that a God can't do. Hey, there's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that Jesus can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, 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 oh,
Serve a risen Savior. Amen. Yes, we do. Hey, welcome to First Baptist Church, Cold Spring. My name is Stacy. I work with our students here, and we're glad that you're here this morning. And if you're a guest, we're especially glad to have you. There are some guest cards, connection cards right in front of you. If you would, throughout the service, take a moment, fill that out, and then pass it. You can put it in the offering boxes right outside in the foyer. So we would love to have a record of you being here today. There's some information you can see on the screen right there. How about these new projectors, man? They are bright, aren't they? I mean, Helen Keller could see these things, okay? This is good stuff. All right, well, hey, welcome this morning. Listen, we want to take a moment to say thank you to our veterans. If you have served our country, we want to say thank you for your service. We appreciate you. We live in a society today that's not so thankful all the time. But just remember, you're the greatest people. And we appreciate you, all right? Hey, yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Let's take a moment and let's say hello to each other in the name of the Lord, all right? So go around and greet each other in the name of the Lord.
Start making your way back to your seats. We'll continue with worship. Of the Lord today. We
won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Let's join in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, renewed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Lift up your praise.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Oh, we'll shout out your praise.
Upon that cross,
Here I am to worship. Here I am to count. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together worthy. All together worthy. All together wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. To bear it alone. And I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now. I'm laying it down. And I know that I need you. I run to the Father. Fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, the reason away. My heart needs a searching, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. Saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have the context for that kind of love. Don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, the reason away. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Whoa, 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 again and again. Sights long before my first breath, running into your arms, turning to life from death. And I feel this rush deep in my chest. Your mercy is golden now, just as I am. Done with the hiding, reason away. So I run to the Father again, again, and again, and again. Whoa.
God, there are so many different people in this room from so many different walks of life and journeys and stories, Lord. And I don't know all of them, but I just pray that right now they come running home to you, Lord. That their heart can find a surgeon, and that their soul can find a friend, Lord. It's in your heavenly name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. Good to see you guys this morning. Hey, I want you to open your Bibles. I'm going to go ahead and tell you ahead of time so you have some time to look for it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. All right, just go ahead and you can kind of be turning there. We're going to begin this new series today. I'm entitling it Giving Thanks For. And it's going to be a three-week series. We'll culminate the last Sunday of Thanksgiving. We're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper. We'll be looking at a topic there, and that'll be what we'll be doing on that Sunday. Today, though, we're going to talk about, here's the title, You're Important. And that's what we'll look at today. In the month of October, for whatever reason, and I don't know who started it, and it's just been around a long time, it's become, in the United States at least, what they call Pastor Appreciation Month. And it's a month that's set aside, and churches are encouraged to show appreciation to their staff with cards and gifts and meals and whatever. And I don't know who came up with that idea, but the whole context of it is that, look, staff are paid to do a job, but doing a job doesn't always get reciprocated with feelings of appreciation. And so I don't know who started it. And granted, individuals, we can't live our life, and we won't last long in ministry if we're living for appreciation. Our tank could get empty pretty quick if that's what we need and to continue on. But it is nice to know, isn't it, that you're appreciated. So I just want to say to you on behalf, and I'm going to speak for our staff, thank you for your kindness, your expressions of appreciation, for gifts and cards, words that you gave us, the cruises that we got. Yeah, right. that's a joke, right? Somebody says, Phil fishing for a cruise. I don't know if I want to do a cruise, to be honest with you. Seems boring, but I know you guys like them. But anyway, I want to take today, here's what I really want to focus on. I want to take today and to say to you who are a part of the First Family, you are important. You're important. And I want you to hear me say that. And as a staff, I want you to hear me say that on our behalf, that you and what you do to help the First Family share the gospel and advance God's kingdom in San Jacinto County is acknowledged, and we thank you for what we do together as a family. Unlike some denominations or religious traditions where they hire a group of guys or gals to go do the ministry, which is not biblical, by the way, the biblical model is that everybody is a minister, and the way Scripture sets it up is the pastors are, and the other roles in the church are to equip people as administrators to do the ministry of the church. And I just want to say thank you for doing that ministry. Because whatever happens good through our church in this community and in our church or happens in the lives of people, as a staff, I'm just going to tell you, we cannot and do not take credit for it. It is you. It is us together that is expanding and influencing the church of God for his name's sake and making it happen. And without you, it wouldn't work. In fact, I want to take a moment to recognize some people this morning. Stacy, do you have that microphone? Can you turn it on for me? If you work on Sunday morning, every Sunday, 1 hour, 30 minutes, I don't care. But if you work, thank you, Stacy. If you work in kids' ministry from preschool through elementary on a Sunday morning, would you stand up? I don't care what it is. I don't care how long it is. If you do that, all right, I want you to come down here. In fact, I want you to come down front. Yeah, you're going to come down front. All right. If you work in kids' ministry on Sunday morning, that might be one Sunday, that might be once a quarter. I don't care what it looks like, whatever it is. It might be a greeter. You might change diapers. You might do that. All right. All right, come on. There you go, Brad. Come on down. Yeah, and we got some folks that aren't here. Susan, you can come down. You can leave the projector. Come on down here, Susan. So Susan's involved, and we got some folks that are doing children's ministry. So I want to ask a couple of questions. Tate,
and where is Brittany?
Brittany, what? Okay, so we're going to talk about following spiritual leaders in rebellion here a little bit later. So we're going to get to that one. All right. Of course, Matthew's in kids ministry. So we have a bunch of folks in kids ministry. So let me go down here to this one here. Brad, this is Brad. We discovered when we got to Cold Spring that we're related. Yeah, he's related to Jennifer, so that makes us all related. So, Brad, what do you do in kids ministry?
I help with the nursery.
You help with the nursery? That means you hold babies?
Sometimes.
Do you rock them?
Yeah. Sometimes I change them.
Change the baby or the diaper?
The diaper.
All right. Susan, this is Susan Caldwell. She works in our tech ministry, and she does a little bit of every other things around here. What do you do in kids ministry, Susan?
I work in the nursery once a month, and I do the things that Brad says and that he does, and then we also get in the floor, chunk off our shoes, and play with the kids. So, yeah.
And you help Tom up.
And I help Tom get up.
Tom is her husband, right? So he's in there. All right, April, what do you do in kids ministry?
On Sunday mornings, for first and fifth Sunday at 9 a.m. and 10:30, I work in the pre-K kinder.
Okay. Do you change the kids or the diapers?
No. I'm very lucky. All of ours are party trained.
All right. Tate, what do you do? You're a senior?
Yes.
Senior, Tate's a senior this year. And so what do you do in kids on Sunday mornings?
On Sunday morning, one Sunday a month, I go and I help the kids. And they're like third through sixth grade. And I just, we lead the lessons and we play fun games. And we make sure we all behave and have a lot of fun.
We all behave. I noticed you said that. That's a good thing. So now you work during the worship service, 10:30 service. Okay, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. All right, Miss Anita.
Yes, sir.
What do you do on Sunday mornings?
9 o'clock, I teach the fourth through sixth grade.
At 9 o'clock, the small group.
9 o'clock.
Time. Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. There's a lot of folks I don't know. Michelle, I'm skipping this one here. There's a
reason. Pre-K and kindergarten.
You work pre-K and kindergarten? Like at 9 o'clock or 10:30?
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock? How often do you do it?
Once a month.
Once a month? Okay. All right.
And kids worship once a month at 10:30.
At 10:30, all right. Rachel Lynn and Janet, all right.
What nursery 10:30 last Friday, Sunday. Except if April needs me, I'm a floater, and I give Joetta the diapers. I make her change the diapers.
Joetta works in our children's preschool ministry all the time. All right, Erica.
I do 9 o'clock. I do the second Sunday for pre-K. I also fill in wherever needed, and sometimes I do slides.
All right. All right. All right. And Brittany, what do you do?
I help at the 10:30, or I help over there in children's ministry every first Sunday.
The first Sunday of each month. Okay. Yeah. Once a month. All right. So then I'm going to go back to Jennifer. This one is my wife. I can skip her sometime. All right. So Jennifer, just for Sunday morning, what do you do?
Well, I create a PowerPoint almost every Sunday for children's ministry so that we have our songs and our videos that there's a talk about.
And you don't get to do the sermon thing. Just tell us what you do.
And then I teach the children during 10:30, the main part of the lesson, and then they get dispersed into small group to apply that lesson that they learned with me.
Okay. All right. So there are, there's Matthew. Matthew, come over here. Come over here, Matthew. All right, come over, Matthew. Hey, Matthew, you work with kids ministry on Sunday morning?
Yes.
So what do you do?
We just kind of like show them games and stuff, and we take them outside to the playground and play with them. We just keep them entertained and like, it's fun. Pretty cool.
Leave them hanging up in the swing. So what do you, but they're teaching the Bible during the time. What age group?
I teach the ones that they're not the big pre-K. Ones, but like the middle ones.
Pre-K kinder,
that. The medium kids.
Medium. Okay. Sure. We'll take anybody. Hey, look, these folks, and we have folks in children's ministry there, and we have folks that are not here today that are still involved in the children's ministry. These are people that are doing something every week or during the month. They are the ones who help make it possible for children to be loved, to experience the love of God, and to be able to hear the Word of God and be able to encourage not only the children, but they're encouraging their parents, and so that parents can do work together. Because the church is called to partner with families in raising kids to be godly and to know Jesus. So, hey, give it up for these guys. Thank y'all so much. And by the way, they are living to tell the story, which means that we have some places available to serve on Sunday morning for our kids' ministry. And so if you would consider volunteering, I would appreciate you doing that. See April. Now, I want to recognize some more people. I'm not going to ask you to come down here. If you lead an adult small group ministry on Sunday morning or during the week, it doesn't matter, but on Sunday morning, during the week, if you lead an adult small group ministry, I just want you to stand up where you are. I'm not going to ask you to come down. We're not going to interview you. All right. Come on, Wade. You got to stand up for this one, Wade. You got to stand up. All right, we got this is Sunday morning. Who? Where's Ben? Ben, you and April, y'all work on that together, so stand up, Ben. Ben, all right? Okay, so we have small group ministries that are going on Sunday morning at 9 o'clock. We have ministries that are going on, small group ministries during the week. And these are the people that are, you saw the kids' people. They're the people in the background. Nobody kind of knows who they are. There are people involved, and some of the people know who these are because they're meeting in the classes. You need to know who are studying and working hard, because these are the backbone of what's going on at the church, is our small group ministries. Thank y'all so much. All right. Now I want to recognize, if you are a part of the worship team, which means you might sing once a quarter, you might sing once a month, I don't care, you might sing every, if you play an instrument or if you're a vocalist, that means you're in the choir too, or you're part of the tech ministry, I want you to stand up. I want you to stand up. All right, Susan, all right, everybody stand up in the worship. Y'all see these people, and you got some choir people, right? Don't there some folks that sing in the choir? RJ, there you go. Thank you, Ben, for calling him out. You got some other folks that sing in the choir, all right? Now, these people, now, and I want you to turn around and look at those people in the back. All right, yeah. So normally on Sunday morning, when they get looks from people in the crowd, that means there's a problem. All right, so today you're getting smiling looks back there. All of these people are going on and doing things. They work during the week. They're making our worship experience happen by leading us or preparing it in their all backgrounds. Thank y'all so much for what you do. Thank you for leading us. Y'all can be seated. Now, I want to pay attention to some other folks. If you serve on a committee or a ministry team, ongoing committee or ministry team in our church, would you stand up? An ongoing ministry, an ongoing committee, any kind of team. All right. Is everybody standing up? Look around. Make certain we have to call somebody out. I don't know. All right, good. All right. Hey, Debbie, Luzier, I'm gonna call you. You work on Wednesday night, Team Kids Serving Food, right? Oh, yeah, I'm calling you out. Yeah. Anybody else do that? Anybody else? Yeah, you work any ministry team or committee anywhere in the church. Okay. Thank y'all for what you do, because a lot of what you do is background stuff. It's in the background, but you're making ministry happen. And if it wasn't for you, we wouldn't be seeing ministry happen. Thank y'all so much for doing that. Now, I want to ask you, I'm gonna do a different group here. I don't want you to stand up, but I want to say thank you for obeying Christ and the Word of God. If you don't stand up, if you tithe, or if you give on a, you say, well, Phil, I'm not at the tithing point yet because I've come out of a bad debt to income stuff. It's a mess, but I'm working towards obeying Christ and tithing. But if you're giving consistently towards tithing, or if you're tithing, I just want to say, thank you. That's your worship with God. It's an obedient thing, but it's because of what you're giving and worshiping God that allows us to do what we do. Because if you didn't, we would not have a building with electricity. We wouldn't have the new projectors that we just had installed this week that actually show color. We wouldn't be able to buy Bible study material or send money to missions around the world, globally, locally, or in our country. If it wasn't for you saying, God, here it is, here's, and some of you might, it's not the how many digits that your check makes up. That's not what God looks at. He looks at what does it cost you. Remember the woman at the widow's mite? Jesus said she gave the most of anybody that day. Now, we would count it in the bank as the smallest amount, but she gave the most, Jesus said, because of what it cost. So thank you for doing that. And then there are some people, and I'm not going to ask you to stand up, that are prayer warriors. I'm not talking about you that pray sometimes. I'm talking about the prayer warriors. And there's a difference between people that pray and prayer warriors. Because most of us are believers pray. But I have discovered that in a given church, that the whole church generally isn't a prayer warrior group church. It takes a long time to get there. But there are some people that pray, and they're prayer warriors, and they go and they fight the spiritual battles, and they pray it in their closets or they're on their knees. And when you say to them, would you pray with me? They don't need to know details, but you can take it to the bank. They're going to go to God, and they're going to persevere, and they're going to stay there saying, God, you're a big God, and you're bigger than the problems. You're bigger than the issues. Do something in this life. So thank you for prayer warriors. Thank you. It's important that we fight the battle spiritually. And prayer is the power that draws on the power of God. And we have people who serve on Wednesday nights. We have people who are serving all during the week on the different committees and Bible studies. All of this makes what we do for God work. It makes it work. And without you, who would have done what you did this year? It might not have gotten done. You're important. You're critical to the kingdom. And I want to take a look at 1 Thessalonians this morning. And I want to give you a little background, though, before we look in the chapter of You're Important, because we're going to discover some things of what the Bible says about appreciation and about your importance. But before we do, let me give you a little background before we read the first chapter. Now, the city of Thessalonica is still in existence today. It is referred to, it's got two different names when you refer to it. It's in Greece. It's the second largest city in Greece, and it will be referred to as Thessalonica or Salonica. So let me say this. Let me make certain I'm looking at it because I don't always say it correctly. Salonica. And today, it's still in Greece. Paul encountered this city on his second missionary journey. After he had given his life to Christ, he started a church in Thessalonica. Paul, a guy named Silas, and a young man named Timothy went to on this missionary journey, and he went to this city, and it was a thriving city there on the beach of the Mediterranean. It was an incredible city. It was thriving at that time, and they went there to tell people about Jesus. And the people in the town were so open, and they're saying somewhere, depending on the scholar, some say it was somewhere maybe 100,000, 70 to 100,000, could have been 200,000 people in the city at the time. And what was amazing was they were open to hearing about Jesus, so much so, and so many of them became followers of Christ in just 3 weeks that they started a church there in Thessalonica. Now, Paul only stayed there for 3 weeks, and there's a reason. Because a mob formed in Thessalonica, and they went after him to kill him. And they went after him to kill him for what? Teaching Jesus. And you know who was leading the mob? Jewish people. It was the Jews. I mean, after all, it was the Jewish leaders and religious people that had Jesus crucified. And now we're coming some years later, and it's still some of that group of people or generation of them that's after Paul. And they had to sneak Paul out of town at night so they wouldn't kill him. And Paul wrote two letters to this local church. And he wanted to address some significant issues within the church. And when you read it, and that the two letters, that's what you discover. And let me highlight probably what I would say would be the four major issues that the church was facing. They were facing confusion about the return of Jesus. You see, some of them were saying, well, Jesus is coming back right now. It's imminent. In fact, it was so lopsided, their misunderstanding about the return of Christ, that they began to look at it and say, well, the persecution, we are being persecuted for following Jesus, it's so great that it means that his return is imminent, and it could be before I finish the sentence. So you know what they did? They stopped working. You don't need to pay a mortgage if you're not going to be here. You don't need to pay a car note, well, or a donkey note, if you're gone. You don't need to go buy groceries if you're not going to be here to eat them. And they were so convinced that Jesus was coming because the persecution was so great, and their understanding of the scriptures was so great that Jesus was going to come any moment. So they quit working. They just quit. They just sat around. Now, do you ever get the impression that there's a lot of folks in churches today that are so caught up in the second coming of Jesus that all they do is study, and they really don't do anything but sit around and study it? Our church is unlike the Thessalonian church in some ways. Well, there's another issue. Sexual immorality. You see, sexual immorality was so accepted as normal in the city that that attitude was bleeding into the church, where people in the church began to compromise or justify sexual immorality. Does that sound like a topic of today's church? Right? Well, then there was a third issue, is some church members were not respecting, they did not respect, and they didn't honor the spiritual leaders that were in the church. Didn't it sound, again, it's like, hey, some of this is today, contemporary. And then the last thing is the persecution was so great on those believers that discouragement was entering into the local church. And Paul, they needed to be encouraged by not looking at their moment, but looking at the future with hope. So I want us to learn some things about giving thanks, because that's how Paul starts this whole letter, especially being grateful for servants of the church, servants in the local church. And Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians, and I want to encourage you to look in your own Bibles or look in your digital Bible, whatever it looks like, and let's read this, and then we're going to unpack a few things this morning. And I hope that when we finish, you feel valued and encouraged and challenged. So Paul starts off in verse 1. Now, the way they wrote letters were interesting back then. We say, "Dear Troy." And that's not how they start the letters. Paul says to the Thessalonians, he wants to let them know who's writing the letter. He says, "Paul, Silas, and Timothy." In other words, this letter is coming from them, the three of them. "To the church of Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace to you." Now look in verse 2. "We always thank God for all of you and continually mention you in our prayers." We thank God for you and we mention you in our prayers. "We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, loved by God, that he who has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit and deep conviction. You know how we lived among you for your sake." They only lived there 3 weeks. 3 weeks. "You became imitators of us and of the Lord. For you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. And so you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia." That would be like the state of Texas kind of thing, a whole region area, right? In Macedonia and in Achaia. "Your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it. For they themselves report what kind of reception you gave us. They tell how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and the true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath." Let's unpack a few things about this whole idea about you're important and about appreciation. Paul wants to talk to them about some issues because there is no local church that is perfect. Y'all agree to that? So if you're looking for one, you're not going to find it. As one preacher said, if you do find one and you join it, you just will make it imperfect. We're not a perfect church. But what Paul does is he wants to talk to them about some issues, but he wants to say something. And I love what he says. "I just want you to know, I thank God every day for you." So write this down in your notes. We should express appreciation for those who serve God. That's what Paul did. Paul expressed genuine appreciation for those in the church. It was not flattery. It wasn't empty words. It wasn't, "Hey, you did a good job today." It wasn't, "Hey, that was," it was specific. And people need to feel appreciated. And one of the things that I learned a long time ago in ministry, I'm not good at it all the time. I'm not always good at it because I get focused on the task, and I sometimes get so focused on the task, I forget that the people are what's important. Even the people that's being ministered to, that's one thing, but the people doing the ministry, that's important. So it reminds us that we need to express appreciation to those you who are serving the Lord. I'm not talking about staff, okay? October's gone. I'm talking to you. Genuine appreciation needs to be expressed specifically, and it needs to come from the heart. I want you to look how Paul was specific when he said, hey, I want you to know I thank God for you, I appreciate you, and he gets real specific. He says, your work produced by faith. Now, when I first read this text, when I was preparing the sermon, it said your work produced by faith and then your labor. And I'm thinking, well, Paul is redundant here. But then when I started doing some word study, I discovered, no, he is very specific. He says your work produced by faith. Work is the word in the Greek language, which it was written in. It is the word for a specific task or job. They were sharing the gospel with those who didn't know Jesus. That's a specific task. They had started a new church, and they were doing ministry in that church. They were doing specific tasks that needs to be done. We've identified several specific tasks that's happening in our church this morning, and he's saying, I want you to know your faith in Christ has produced a work. And you're doing this work because of your faith in Christ. And that is the work of God that God's called all of us, sharing the gospel. He's called all of us to do that work. You see, their faith in Jesus changed their lives so much that they told others about Jesus. The question would be, is your faith enough to change your life, to put you to doing work for the God? Paul said, your work is produced by your faith in Jesus. And I'm going to tell you, I'm thankful for that. And then he says, your labor is prompted by love. Now they're doing work, a task, but then he uses the word labor, and it's not the same word there. The word labor is more than doing a task. Labor refers to the intensity of doing the task. You have a work to do, and now when he says your labor, that's the love that you have for Christ, that you have for other people, it is creating an intensity of doing that. If you're a mother, you can appreciate that word labor, can't you? They go to the hospital, and there's a section in the hospital, the hallway, and it's named labor and delivery. I remember when our oldest daughter was in labor with our first grandchild. She was in the labor and delivery room, and the curtains were pulled, and her sisters, two of her sisters, they couldn't be there, and so they had it on FaceTime, at least the starting of it. And I got to tell you something, and she doesn't need to know this. Well, I guess I could tell her today because that was a long time ago. It was funny. Things were kind of calm. Doctor giving this instruction, doing that instruction, and getting her ready. And then as time went on, the intensity of the situation deepened. If you're a mama, you know that, right? The first part of labor is like, okay, just get me all hooked up. But as you go through labor, intensity increases. So Rachel was on FaceTime with her sister, and it had gotten to a very intense time. She was breathing, and Brad was trying to help her breathe, you know, slow down, breathe. And she finally says to him, stop telling me how to breathe. And finally, it gets pretty intense. And just before the baby's coming, it gets so intense with sternness in her eyes and in her voice. She looks straight to the phone that was on FaceTime, and she says to her sister, "Adoption is a good option." And we laughed just like you. We didn't laugh out loud. When a mama's in labor, you don't laugh out loud, right? You be quiet because you could be dead. We were careful, but it was funny. Now, what enables a mother to be willing to have more children after that painful labor? It's love. Because there's something about the love for that child that helps them forget the intensity of the labor. The Thessalonians were so intense and so passionate in sharing about Jesus to those in the city. They were prompted by their love for Jesus and their love for the people in the city that they did it. Is your love for Jesus causing you to talk about Him? Is your love for others enough to cause you to help them know Jesus and His forgiveness and eternal life? There is nothing about giving labor or going through labor and birth to a child that's convenient. It's intense. The Thessalonians were intense. And the third thing he says, I'm going to tell you, your endurance inspired by hope in the Lord Jesus. The believers in the church were experiencing great persecution because they followed Jesus. And greater persecution when they were telling others about Jesus. It just kept getting intense against them. And you know what it is to become discouraged. The people were becoming discouraged because they looked around them and people in the city, on their block, on their neighborhood were attacking them. They were ridiculing him. They were calling him names, and discouragement can kind of sit in on the best of us, and discouragement is contagious. And it can begin to affect other people when we're discouraged. But they were enduring the pain because they possessed the hope. And Paul encouraged them, keep enduring, keep looking to the hope, because this will be over someday. Because Jesus is going to come back. And when he sets up this new earth, it's going to be different. And the circumstances that you're living in, look beyond them to the hope and the return of Jesus Christ. You may feel that you're enduring a great hardship this morning. You may say, this is hard. Paul would say, I understand. But look beyond the circumstances to the future of what Jesus is going to do. I got to show you a lady that I think exemplifies endurance. That's Dorothy Bridges. Dorothy is 99 years young. Dorothy was told by her family, April, her granddaughter, one of them, you don't need to be at the fall festival, Graham, because it's going to be cold. You stay at home and we'll take care of it. And so I assume that Miss Dorothy wouldn't be here, and I'm walking down the cars talking to everybody, and I see Dorothy. And she's kind of shivering because it's cold. I said, Miss Dorothy, weren't you told not to come tonight? And she said, yes. I said, and Miss Dorothy, it appears that you don't always listen to others. And she smiled and she said, correct. I said, they couldn't keep you away from loving on these kids, could they? And she said, no. Now, Miss Dorothy has some physical challenges. In fact, Bonnie took her to the emergency room this morning. She's not here. She's got some medical challenges. She's 99 years young. But she never offers her age, her challenges, the fact that she's on a walker, and yes, she can run circles around Bonnie. She never offers excuses. She just keeps going and going and going. She really is a picture of endurance. She's just not going to stop. Because one day, she said to me, one day we were talking, she said, one day I will be in Jesus in my new house. Let's look at number two real quickly. We are to reproduce followers of Jesus. That's disciples. In verse 6, Paul said, you became imitators of us and the Lord. Why is it important to have standards and values for those who teach, lead, or have influencing roles in the church? Because we want those that they are influencing to become like them. That's what Paul said. And Paul said he is like Jesus. Because they are what others are looking at to be able to imitate. Now, how do we establish standards or values for those who teach, lead, or have influencing roles in the church? We should go to the Bible. Our church expects every individual to be a biblical disciple. It doesn't matter what religious traditions they were raised in or who their parents were. It is especially important that those who lead are what we believe others need to imitate. Paul identifies some of those characteristics in this chapter, and we're going to cover them very quickly. It's not exhaustive, but look at the list of discipleship characteristics that he refers to. He says, hey, we're to be reproducers of or reproduction or reproduce followers of Jesus. Look what he says. He says, what kind of people are you? You're the kind of people that follow spiritual leaders. He said, you became imitators. They followed the heart and the actions of Paul, Silas, and Timothy as they follow Jesus. The independent attitude that we possess in America, and especially here in Texas and in the rural part of Texas, is good and it's done some great things, but it can sometimes lead to demanding of our rights. And it can lead to a subtle rebellion. There are some today, like the child at home, who goes to one parent or the other to get what they want. They know how to manipulate the situation. There are many professing Christians in America today that are just like those kids. Jesus said, you're following spiritual leaders. Number two, he said, you're willing to suffer for Jesus. He said, in spite of severe suffering, most of us will never be beat or arrested for following Jesus. We more likely could expect social ridicule, perhaps a loss of a promotion at a job, or maybe rejection by some others. I recall so vividly going back to school that fall and that first day or second day of school after I'd given my life to Christ that summer. My best friend and I met up on the second floor at Sam Houston High School. We ran into one another in the hallway, and I said, "Hey, man, I'm back. I'm back from summer, being out of town." And he just looked at me and he said, "Hey, I hear you got religion." And I looked at him and I said, "I don't think so," but I did make a decision to follow Jesus. And he looked at me and he shook his head with disgust and disdain, and he walked away down that crowded hallway. I remember standing, feeling alone, though the hallway was full of students, as I watched him walk to never speak to me again. And for a brief moment, I felt sorry for myself. And then God spoke to my heart saying this, Phil, think about what I did for you. And then I decided what he did to me was nothing compared to what people did to Jesus. And I said to myself, self, get over it. Quit having a pity party. And maybe he's not really a friend anyway. Because friends accept people for who they are. Do you allow fear to stop you from sharing Jesus where you live, work, and play? Then the next thing he said, you receive God's word. He said they welcome the message. They receive God's word without picking and choosing things they liked or they didn't like. If it was God's word, they accepted it. They read it. Oh, that's what it says. I believe it. The bumper sticker is so wrong that says God said it. I believe it, and that settles it. You see, that's the problem. Many people believe that bumper sticker. That bumper sticker is teaching ungodly truth, information. It should read, God said it, and that settles it. If you want to believe it or not, if you want to obey it or not, it doesn't matter. If God said it, that should settle it. And that was the attitude of the Thessalonians. You know people who approach the Bible like they do a buffet line at a restaurant. A lot of them are like the children. They skip over the food and they go straight to the dessert section because it's easier to swallow. Every time we read the word, we ought to be asking, how does my life need to change? And then he said, you are a model for others to follow. You became a model to other believers. Biblical disciples reproduce by being models for others to follow. Through their actions, through their learned following Jesus, through their prayer life, through their attitude. That's what they are. See, all of us are models. I guess the question is what kind of model are we? If people imitate us, are they becoming a more biblical disciple? Are they looking more like Jesus? And then the last thing he said, sharing the gospel with enthusiasm. I love this verse in 8, verse 8. The Lord's message rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Caia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere. We don't even need to tell anybody about it. That phrase rang out. Do you know that what it means? I wish we could all read Greek in its original language. The phrase rang out refers to an energetic blast of a trumpet. He said, with enthusiasm, it's a sense of enthusiasm, the believers were making Jesus known throughout the entire city and the countryside. They were enthused. They were energetic. They were excited about it. And people would say, hey, you know that church over there? Yeah, yeah. What about it? You know, that's the church that's telling everybody about Jesus. That's a church that's accepting everybody and they're loving them and they're telling people about Jesus. That church had a reputation for being the church that told people about Jesus and loved people, and it earned that reputation. I wonder, what is the reputation of the average local church in America today? Do they say about First Baptist? That's that church over there. Man, that church is telling people about Jesus. So let me just say this. Thank you for serving. Thank you for making Jesus known in our community. And I do thank God for you that serve. I enjoy serving with you. Three questions. Are you a model for Jesus, of Jesus, for others to follow? What do you need to adjust to be a model for others to follow? Will you make that adjustment? Let's pray. Father, thank you for the people that serve in this church. Whatever is accomplished, Lord, it's because of the people in this room and those who make up this church that are not here in this room. Father, that church in Thessalonica, it was making a difference. Thank you. It wasn't perfect. I thank you for our church. We got places to improve, things to do better. But God, we're on a journey becoming what you want us to be. And thank you for those who join in and serve. Maybe there's some, Lord, that are looking for a place to be a part of something bigger than they are. And this is the place you're calling them. God, I thank you in Jesus' name. Let everyone walk out today feeling loved and feeling valued. I pray it in your name, Jesus. We're going to sing this song. Would you stand? And Stacy and I are here to pray with you or for you. Let's stand and sing this song. If you want to give your life to Christ, or maybe God is speaking to you, we're here to pray with you. Would you come and do that? Let's sing this song together.
So sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his cross, just to know the Savior. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, born for grace to trust him.
Let's pray for our offering. Can we do that? Father, thank you that we have the privilege of giving to you as an expression of obedience and as an expression of worship to you. Take the tithe, take the offering that we give, use it for your glory. I pray that in your name, Jesus. Amen. We won't be passing an offering plate in our church because we don't do that. In the bulletin, there's tells you how to do that digitally, and there's offering boxes in the foyer. We've got a couple of quick announcements, and they're going to be so quick you can stay standing, and Stacy's going to give them to you. And And I didn't name every group by name in our church, but one of them that is involved in our, we do a lot of next gen ministry is we have a lot of folks that are involved in our student ministry. And we need to recognize them. Well, if you stand up, well, you're already standing, right? Just kind of wave your hand. You've been involved in our student ministry kind of thing. All right, there you go. All right, thank you so much. Stacy, cover us real quick.
Absolutely.
We'll enjoy lunch.
Yes. So I'll get you out of here as quick as possible. We have our Angel Tree Ministry. You are a very giving church, and we thank you for supporting our community. So there's opportunities. So you can go to the back and or talk with April on how to invest in that. Also, our Turkey Bowl is coming up this next Sunday. So weather permitting, we'll be able to have that out at the high school field. We're going to have three officials out there, officials, all right? Not just somebody running around the shirt looking good, but real officials and everything. So we're excited about that. And then finally, we have Christmas on the Square, December the 9th. So we are looking for volunteers to work in our ministry. So if you would call April on that as well, we appreciate it. You guys, oh, and Surviving the Holidays. That's not written here, but we'll say it. Surviving the Holidays is
so we got some more
seminar
these?
November the 18th from 12 good, to good. 2 p.m. There's a potluck dinner, and the cost is $7.
Okay.
So if you need more information, good. Call the church office on that. Hey, you guys have a great week. We love you, and we will see you next Sunday.
He's wearing, since Shepherd won, he's wearing Shepherd blue. He's waiting on me.